I'm Joseph Ferrie. I'm in the Economics Department and the History Department here at Northwestern, and I'm a faculty associate at the Institute for Policy Research here at Northwestern. There's a real need for data that follows people over long spans of time, that allows you to look at things that happen to them very early in life and still be able to follow them up, not just through their teen years or their 20s, but through middle age, even into their senior years and up to the end of their lives. And unfortunately, creating that sort of data prospectively is prohibitively expensive. Following people from a cohort that you draw today for the next 80 years is just real tough to do. There's a lot of attrition, there's a lot of expense involved, and it's generally inconvenient to have to wait another 80 years to start to get the full set of results. So what I've been doing for most of the last 10 years or so is creating data of the same sort that follows people from infancy to death, but doing it retrospectively, taking populations of people that we know are now deceased, who may have died as recently as yesterday in some cases, and following them back to their early life circumstances. So one example is we have a large population of people that we know were born between 1890 and 1899 that we then are able to follow into the U.S. Census in 1940. And in 1940, they're adults, they're in their 40s, we can observe their income and their educational attainment. But based on where they were born, we also can figure out how much lead they were exposed to in the drinking water in the cities where they lived. And that's easy to calculate if you know something about the piping material that was used in each city and what the pH of the water supply was, because there's a nice, well-determined relationship that water chemists know between the pH of a water supply and how much lead leaches into the water for a given amount of piping. So we can do that, and we can then look at people's outcomes in their 40s and 50s, and we see clearly that people who are in places that would have received a larger dose of lead in their early years up until age 10 do considerably worse in terms of income, educational attainment, hours and weeks worked. And we can do the same for IQ. We can follow these people into World War II enlistment records, where we have, for 500,000 guys, their IQ at the time of enlistment. And it'll cost you roughly 6 IQ points, depending on how bad the pH is in your location, but it's a clear and large effect, and it's way more than any minimal statistical significance level would require to draw any conclusions. So it's a result that's both large in magnitude and highly significant statistically, and consistent with what we know about results from the medical literature on the effect of lead poisoning on children and their cognitive capacity. So being able to do that is something you could only do over a very long span of time by following kids like the ones who are being dosed with lead in Flint, Michigan today, and following them for the next 50 or 80 years to see what their outcomes are. Here we can do that very easily with a historical population. You can do the same thing with late-onset Alzheimer's, which also has a significant environmental component because there's very little genetic information that's likely to lead to late-onset Alzheimer's. It occurs in your late 70s. There's no evidence in twin studies that this has a significant genetic component, so it's got to be environmental. But we don't know what the effect of early life lead exposure is on people who later develop late-onset Alzheimer's, because there is no data that follows them from an early life measure of their lead exposure to the probability of them getting such a diagnosis later in life. We can use the data that we have to accomplish exactly that. We have a sample of people that we observe born in the 1930s. We know what cities they're in, and again, we can approximate how much lead they were exposed to in the local water supply. And these are people who, by the year 2000, are now entering the Medicare system, and we can observe them over the course of the ensuing 20 years or so and observe how many of them do come down with a late-onset Alzheimer's diagnosis, and in that way do something that no data in the existing set of things that people in public health have at their disposal could actually accomplish, being able to say something about that early exposure. That's just two examples of what I think is nice about using historical data, that it's there, it's accessible, it's relatively inexpensive compared to doing things prospectively, and it provides these kind of neat natural experiments. I'll just mention one other, which is a land lottery that was conducted in the state of Georgia in 1832. the state of Georgia gave away most of the land in the state as it became available, which means as they were able to remove large portions of the indigenous population. In 1832, they basically lotteried off the entire northwest corner of modern Georgia, what becomes the 10 counties in the northwest, including where modern-day Atlanta is located. We're able to follow the subsequent careers of the winners and the losers and observe not just outcomes that they themselves experience, but what their children and grandchildren experience up to 50 years subsequent to the lottery. It's a wonderful experiment because economists very rarely get to see a big pile of money, what we call a windfall, dropped into someone's lap, completely exogenous to their own characteristics. Unlike modern lotteries that have participation among a population that's highly selected, this was a lottery where pretty much the entire state of adult males participated, and it didn't cost you anything to enter. The prize was enormous. You'd win a plot of land that was equal to about median wealth in the state of Georgia at this time. So it's a big pile of money, randomly distributed to the entire population with our ability to follow those people up subsequently. Three things come out of that are worth noting. One is that it doesn't appear that 20 years after the lottery, there's much difference in the distribution of wealth between winners and losers, which means that somehow the winnings have been dissipated and they make no long-term impact on what the distribution of wealth looks like. Second, it looks as though there are no outcomes that are superior for the children. Children of lottery winners are no different than the children of those who participated but did not win in terms of their wealth, their occupational attainment, their literacy level, and the same is true for the grandchildren. So going down through the third generation, there's no real impact from this huge infusion of cash. What does this mean in terms of policy? Well, it suggests that to the extent that outcomes are correlated at this time between parents and children, it's not something obvious like money itself that's being transferred across the generations. There must be something deeper and more fundamental in attitudes, in practices, in social connections or competencies that allow some children to do better than others, and the ones that are doing better than others are also coming from parents who had themselves done better than others because of these things. And simply injecting a pile of money into the system doesn't have a large, if any, impact on how the ones who were doing poorly would have children do better in the subsequent generations. So that's kind of what I do and why I do it.